and I would always be little, I would say, bored of reading my textbooks. I always have wanted to read my novels and my fiction and other things. So many a times we feel that briefs are a burden. So don't allow it to become a burden. Treat it like a fiction, treat it like a novel, and you'll really enjoy your work. The other is, you must know your facts absolutely correctly. Remember one thing, if you know your facts well, the law takes its own course. Law is secondary. Do not get completely overwhelmed by looking at the law in the first instance. No. If you know your facts completely, believe you me, law will automatically help you. More often than not, we don't know our facts well. And that's where a real problem arises. So try and marshal the facts as best as you can. And for that, you must read the brief, in a very, very different way. Unless you have read the brief first fully, do not make notes. If you want to make notes, then you read the full brief, then you can start making the notes about various dates, because there will be a lot of gaps that you will have. Never read list of dates. Never read list of dates. So that's little something. When a client comes, for example, unfortunately in India, our clients don't maintain the kind of records which foreign clients do. But when a client comes to you for the first time, let's say you are drafting an SLP, always gather as much information from the client as you can. And not just what is provided in the papers that he gives you. No. Question him as if you are cross-examining him. Get as much, because more often than not, you will find that either client is ignorant or that he wants to hide something. Now he hides something, you prepare an SLP, you draft it, and next thing you find is that the other side points out that you have suppressed something vital. So, and it reflects on you. Mind you, the client will go away. You are here to stay in this court. And the judge will always think that, Mr. Dave, you never told us about this fact. You have never mentioned it in your specialty petition. So you have to be inquisitorial with the client. If you are, then you will never be able to fail on facts. So that's something which is very important for you to remember. On law, always read the Bare Act. If you read the Bare Act fully, you will never have a problem in any matter. First, read the Bare Act. Read the section with which you are confronted. Then start the research. And the best way to do research is never to look at SCC online. I hope they are not listening. Never look at SCC online. Never look at internet or computer. Look at textbooks. If you want to find the best judgments, look at AIR manual. They have the finest categorization of judgments on any subject, on any section that you can ever need. And then you can move upward. Then look at a textbook. If it is contract, look at Mulla. If it is arbitration law, look at Mr. Malhotra's book or many other books. So if you look at the textbooks, the kind of information, the kind of judgments, the kind of law that you will find will be absolutely outstanding. And you will really love it, because every time you go to the court, you will have absolutely right and apt judgments with you. If you are armed with judgments, I don't think any judge can resist you. Because all that you have to stand up and tell them, my lord, this matter is covered by this so-and-so case. And the judge will immediately sit back. Otherwise, you know what happens on Mondays and Fridays. So it's very important that you must understand. Also, make a lifetime diary. One of my biggest weaknesses has been that I have never maintained a diary. So from your early days, start making a diary of the judgments that you are seeing from time to time. And make it in such a way that it helps you 5, 10, 20, 30 years later. If that diary is maintained properly, as many of them do, I mean, some of the seniors, the peers whom I looked up to when I began this profession, people like Mr. Surabji and all, Mr. Nariman, Mr. Ashok Desai, and Mr. Parasan, they always had their notes, and they always could refer to those notes. I have, and I must say it's my weakness, but in other way, it's my strength, because every time a case comes up, even though it's the same law which I might have dealt with 5 years ago, I will start the research again, and I will always find one or two extra judgments. But I would strongly recommend that you guys have your own diaries, and you must always carry them carefully, because if you have maintained them well, don't I mean you'll be surprised that many of your friends would want to take it away from you. So be careful about that. The other is, most important, that try and read as much extra as possible. If you confine yourself to law alone, then I can tell you one thing, you are not equipped to face the challenges of the legal profession today. So you have to read as many newspapers as you can in a day, including business newspapers like Economic Times and others. You have to read editorials and other articles, which, because everyday newspapers have fantastic content, especially newspapers which are responsible like the Hindu or the Indian Express. You know, they have really good articles. Magazines, try and read as many magazines as you can and read articles on those magazines. Novels, there are lots of fictions, lots of non-fictions which are available which can help you. Because remember, law today is about sociology, it's about philosophy, it's about history, it's about literature, and of all, it's about economics. Now, if we have studied just the law in our law schools or otherwise, we can never be equipped with that. And you know, the country or the world is changing at such a pace that it is this kind of newspapers and magazines which can keep you up to date about the problems which are being confronted by a nation, by legal system, by jurisprudence. So you have to be absolutely up to date about them. Don't remain isolated. That's my very strong request to you, because if you remain isolated, you might be brilliant in law, but then you will not make the most brilliant lawyer. Because, you know, I mean, look at many of the success stories, like Mr. Salve, for example. He's a chartered accountant come, you know, lawyer. Mr. Kirit Rawal was the Solicitor General. He was a graduate from the IIM Ahmedabad. Now, you know, look at the kind of background they had, and that helped them become, you know, what they were. They all became outstanding lawyers. People like Ashok Desai, you know, London School of Economics. They were all, and the kind of reading that person like Ashok Desai has done over his life, sometimes if you get a chance, sit with him in the evening and you can know that this man knows so much about world at large. So much. It's a treat to hear them. There is no subject. Look at Justice Nariman. There is no subject on which he cannot give a lecture. You tell him on religion, he can speak with equal ease about Hinduism or Islam or Christianity or Sikhism, as he can speak on, you know, Western classical music or history. He knows his history backward. He can tell you which of the Turkish rulers had how many wives. Now, that's the kind of a knowledge, you know, people have acquired, and because they read incessantly, they just read about, and that's what has made him, you know, extraordinary today. So that development of mind is a constant process. It's not a process which should ever be stopped. The other is that do always be, never forget that your efforts are going to be, you know, always rewarded. Have faith in yourself. Always very important is that you should never forget that your efforts will be rewarded. Sometimes it happens that some of us are more luckier than others. You know, there is always a stroke of chance in our profession also. It's not just about brilliance. It's not just about opportunities. It's also about stroke of luck. Some of us get that stroke of luck and utilize it. Some of us, you know, face that stroke of luck and fail to utilize it. You have to notice it. So unless and until, and you must have confidence in yourself. If you have confidence in yourself, I had a very large practice in Ahmedabad in 10 years' time. I shifted here in 1986 without any kind of a, you know, godfather. I didn't join anybody's chamber and everything was looking quite bleak to me. But I had the confidence that I want to practice in the Supreme Court and I must strive and work hard to make it successful. That's all I came with. I had nothing else. I had no savings also, frankly. And two of my friends, of course, helped me, to whom I am eternally indebted to. But that's something which you must never forget, that your confidence should never be shaken. Even with 5 dismissals in a row in 1 week, you should not feel that you have failed. No. Please do not judge yourself with the success and failure of matters. Always judge yourself with the effort that you have put in a matter. Result is not in your hands. Result is in the hands of a judge. And it's not always that the judge does justice in the right way. Many a times judges, you know, make an error. Fair enough, so long as those are bona fide, honest errors. So don't, you know, judge yourself with the success. But if you have put in efforts in every matter, the satisfaction that you will derive would be immeasurable. And you will never ever forget that, yes, I worked very hard in this matter. Maybe judge doesn't listen to you. Doesn't matter. He might. But if he sees you five times with complete preparedness, six times, he will definitely not just give you 30 seconds. He will give you 3 minutes. Maybe other six times later, he might give you, 15 minutes. So it's that which is what is important that you should never ever forget. Most important is our etiquette. We are singularly, I would say, missing in our etiquettes in the courts. Our behavior towards each other, our behavior towards seniors, our behavior towards women lawyers are very, very important. Most of all, our conduct in the court is extremely important. You see, I'm sorry to tell you, share this with you, but I must share you. It's little, brutal and hard. But many a times when I'm sitting in the court, I find young lawyers who are wanting to argue a matter or who are even mentioning a matter for passover and adjournment, have not cared to open that one brief and read through it. And that's extremely sad. I used to actually pray to God every day that my senior would not land up in the case. Every day. And I was fortunate that I had a senior who deliberately would miss matters more often than not. And it gave me tremendous, confidence that I could. But because one had to work hard for it. If you do not, and always be very, very polite to the judge, listen to the judge, do not emulate seniors. Seniors are constantly, fighting with each other in the court. We are not the best example. So don't follow us. Do what you think is right. And the right thing is that be calm, be slow, be, not high-pitched voice. Listen to the judge when judge intervenes and then make your submission. It happened the other day, I was sitting in a court of one of the learned judges and one young man was arguing a matter and every time the learned judge wanted to say something, he would jump in and start talking about it. And ultimately the judge got extremely irritated and he threw the brief away. I got up, I intervened, I requested the judge, I first explained to the young man that, look, please say sorry first to the court, then say that please give me a chance. He did that, the judges saw that I had intervened, judges found that I was, trying to intercede to help him, and it helped him, because after he argued, he got a notice. Now, this is where it's very important that you must, but at the same time, do not bow before the judge if the judge is wrong. Stand firm, respectfully. Stand firm. If a judge insults you personally, don't take it lying down. Please stand up to the judge and say that, sorry, sir, this is not what I expect from you. And I am personally hurt that you have said something which is uncharitable to me. Don't miss that opportunity. Remind him politely that please, we must also be respected. Don't be afraid about that. If you are afraid about that, then judges will steamroll you. Don't allow them to steamroll you. Because after all, we are all human beings and we also must have our dignity. So judges must always remember that we respect them. They must in turn respect us completely. And if they cross the line, then politely remind them that you have crossed the line. So you have to stand firm. If you don't have that moral courage within you, then I think you will have a big problem in future. And there's nothing wrong about it, so long as you do it politely. And if ever there is a serious problem, you can always come to me. I would always, intervene on your behalf before any court without hesitation. But if you cross your line, if you are disrespectful and if you, misbehave, then I think it's no. That's not something which is good for us as an institution. So we have to really be very, very careful about that. The other is the dress. Today morning I saw a young lady who was not wearing a band. Every week I remind 2, 3, 4 people that they are not wearing their bands. Every week. I don't know whether many people do it or not, but unfortunately it's in my habit to always remind young and old that you don't have a band. Because we have a code. It's provided under the statute what we should wear. Today a young lady was not only without a band, but she was wearing blue shirt. Now this is unacceptable. Many a times I have seen women lawyers and I have reminded some of the senior advocates on record who come in colorful saris. That's not the dress code. So we must, and believe you me, if your band is tainted with a stain of pan, the judge will always notice it. He will immediately realize that this is not a lawyer who is a clean lawyer. But if you, even if you have two bands, if you can wash them and wear them, you know, neat and clean, you will make an absolute impact. Your hair, your appearance is extremely important to a judge, mind you. If judge finds that you are shabby, you have lost 50% chance of getting any relief from that judge. And that's where, you know, our bar, Supreme Court bar, I must say, is very different from where I come from. In Gujarat, this never used to happen. In Supreme Court, people just walk in without a band. Sometimes they walk in without a gown. I don't think that's right at all. So all of you, please make a conscious decision that for all times to come, you will be impeccably dressed. Even if you have two pairs of clothes, it doesn't matter. When I started, I had two pairs of clothes. Nothing else. I was getting 250 rupees a month. You guys are much more fortunate than what we were. I many a times had to miss my meals because I was sharing my apartment with my servant. So it's not, I mean, it's not that we all have not faced struggle, but it's something which is extremely important for you to remember, that you must win sympathy or heart of a judge by your appearance and by your courtesies. And believe you me, nothing can be a substitute for that. Nothing. 50% of war would be, you know, won over if you bow every time. Now, for example, in Supreme Court, 90% of youngsters do not bow before the judge after they have got an order. Nor do they say grateful. A lot of people say it's an English tradition, but there is nothing wrong about the English tradition. I am one of those who believes that this is the way we respect the judicial system. And it's, you know, if it's like our parents. If our parents give something to us, don't we bow to them? I mean, it's very normal. I'm not saying that we should humiliate or prostrate before the judges. No, please don't misunderstand. But it's a courtesy. And even age-wise, a judge is far more senior in age than most of you. So why not? Even today, I would not fail to, you know, bow to the judge and tell him grateful, or when he adjourns the matter. So you have to. And that will go a long way. Don't forget that, please. That's something I... The other is that you, most important, your personal life outside. Don't think that law is all that you have to live for. You must understand one thing, that law is only one facet of your life. You have a commitment to your family. You have a commitment to your friends. You must honor those commitments. You must, most of all, you have a commitment to yourself. If you cannot find 2 hours to yourself in a day, and you are